Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
So we continue today in our series that we have titled Firstborn Redemption. Our first message in our series, we titled it, Why Do We Need Redemption? Last week we talked about what is redemption. So why do we need redemption? So we said that we need redemption because God wants to restore us to our identity and to our inheritance. So last week in our teaching of what is redemption, we said that redemption is paying the price for someone's freedom. For someone's freedom. Today, our message is, how does God redeem people? How does he do it? I think from last week, if you were here, we're ready, we're prepared, we want to know. And if you weren't here, I'm going to catch you up a little bit. So we need to be restored to our identity and our inheritance, and we're also under oppression, so we need redemption. So what exactly is oppression? What exactly is oppression? I'm glad you asked. Because I have an answer. So I needed a good question. So oppression then is to experience pressure from the enemy to believe and to act different than our identity. So the enemy puts pressure on us so that we can act different than who we are. So that we can believe something different than who we are. That kind of pressure is oppression.
Yes.
So let me ask you, did you experience oppression this week? I sure did. I had several moments of fear. You see, the enemy doesn't, oppression and pressure doesn't always mean a bully coming on you with, you know, like a strong.
Yes.
It can actually be an enticing.
Yes.
Right? Into believing something that is different than who we are.
That's
in the
summer.
It is a pressure to act under circumstances in a way that is different. I don't know about you, but I experienced this pressure to act other than who I am every time that I get behind the wheel. Maybe you don't. Maybe you're that saint that I see on the slow lane going 10 miles slower than the speed limit. And I experience temptation because of you. And I should be more like you. And just go at the limit of the speed. And it's a temptation. And I'm tempted to act other than who I am. Because the truth is, wherever I'm going, I have time. And if I'm late, I'm already late. Now, of course, you know that I am half joking, only half joking. Because we do experience some other pressures that are a little more serious than this.
Yes.
A little more serious. Whether it's through fears, through lies, through the world attempting to conform us into its mold, the enemy applies pressure on us to act other than who we really are
in
the Lord. And how does the enemy do that exactly? Well, he does that by imitating God's voice. That's how he does it. That's how he does it. You see, by imitating God's voice, he attempts to make us believe that it is the Lord's voice partially quoting truth, mm-hmm. partially arguing from a from some kind of truth basis, mm-hmm. but really waiting to ensnare us into its mostly religious trap.
Yeah.
The voice of the enemy in a religious garb is his attempt to imitate, to counterfeit the Lord's voice. Why does he do that? Why is the Lord's voice so important? Well, may I submit to you that the Lord's voice is actually the number one thing in Judaism. Mm-hmm. Did you know that?
Yes.
Shema Israel. Mm-hmm. Hear my voice. Hearing God is number one priority.
Amen.
In the Torah.
Amen.
Hearing God. No wonder it's the enemy's number one priority too. To speak to you with a voice similar to the voice of the groom, similar to the voice of the true shepherd. So last week we said that redemption is delivering people from bondage by paying the price of freedom. The Lord pays the enemy to redeem the people that he is oppressing, and the payment is vengeance, is turmoil, it is wrath. That is what God pays the enemy. Because the enemy takes the people of God without paying anything.
Yes, yes.
And so God delivers them without paying anything.
Yes.
And the price is actually judgment. For oppressing God's people.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
The price that he paid to redeem Israel from Egypt are 10 plagues. That's what he paid. And we saw how our Messiah exposed the host of wickedness.
Yes.
When he died for us. He publicly exposed them, defeating them in his death and resurrection. So his death and his resurrection is the ultimate judgment on the forces of evil, on the oppressor, on the real Pharaoh of this world. And he has destroyed his foundations, his kingdom.
Hallelujah.
And he is simply acting out of lying to us. He has nothing. He has absolutely no cash in the bank. All he can do is give you a bad check. That when you go cash it, there is absolutely nothing. All he can do is lie to you and to me. There's no bite. But the problem is that the lies are so close to the voice of the Lord. And we fall for it. We do. God defeats the enemy by bringing judgment on him, and he sets his people free. Now, the Lord declared through Moses, Exodus 6:6, this is part of what we saw last week. We saw 7 statements of commitment, I will. So this is one of them. It says, I will also redeem you with an outstretched arm and with great judgment. I will redeem you by paying Pharaoh judgment with my outstretched arm. Now the judgments, as we said, are the 10 plagues. And in our Torah portion today, we have the last 3 of those judgments. We have the locust. How many of you know that the locust is demonic attack? Is it not? How many of you know that darkness is demonic attack?
Oh yes.
And death is the altar.
Yes.
So there is one surprising element that is common in all of the plagues. They all are demonic activity. They're all demonic activity. The blood, the lice, the frogs. Have you seen, read in Revelation, the frogs that come, they're spirit, they're unclean spirits.
Yes, yes.
They're all demonic activity. Now, maybe you're asking, are you trying to tell me that God uses demonic activity over the enemy? Yeah, I'm trying to tell you that. Let me give you what I call the Joey principle. The reason is because I haven't read this anywhere, and this is what the Lord showed me. And I wrote extensively about this in my book, and we talked about my book in last week, and if you were here, that's all I'm going to say about my book. And you can Google it and you'll find it. Now, here's the Joey principle. God uses Satan to defeat Satan. God uses the enemy to defeat the enemy. How often do I say that in our home? You can ask my wife. I live by that. I believe in this. The Lord uses the enemy to defeat the enemy. How so? Well, how about we go into a little Bible exploration here. In Luke 11:17, the Lord says, Yeshua said, any kingdom divided against itself is laid waste. And a house divided against itself falls. If Satan also is divided against himself, how will his kingdom stand? Now the Lord knows this principle. He knows that if he can get Satan to fight himself, the whole kingdom falls.
Amen.
So you've read the many, many, many stories in the Tanakh when the armies would come and the Lord will bring confusion in the camp.
Yes.
And what would happen?
Turn on each other.
They turned on each other. Yes. They will fight each other. Yes. They will kill each other. Yes. And the people of God, wow, that was awesome.
Yes.
They're just what they didn't have to fire a single nothing.
Yes.
The Lord knows this principle. He uses it all the time. He turns the enemy against himself.
Yes.
Not only in the Bible. What I'm trying to tell you is that this happens every day in your life and in my life.
Yes, yes, yes.
He uses the enemy to defeat the enemy, the oppressor,
amen,
in your life and in my life.
Amen.
Now, Moses executed God's judgments through his staff. We see all through the Exodus narrative, Moses' staff. This is the same staff. Now think about this. If Moses executes God's judgment with the staff, and the judgments are all about bringing demonic activity on demons, then the staff is an instrument that brings demonic activity. Woo! That's heavy. didn't the staff turn into a serpent?
Yes. Yeah.
Do you think that's good? Isn't that a figure of the enemy? Yes. Of the serpent?
Yes.
So what is the man of God doing walking around with a stick of judgment, of death? Mm-hmm. Well, what happened with the serpents? Didn't God's serpent eat the demon's serpent?
Yes.
So, didn't God use Satan to defeat Satan? Mm-hmm. Sure did.
Very good.
He sure did.
Sure did.
Wow. You see, many times when we pray for the Lord's help, for the Lord's deliverance, for the Lord's intervention, we may not be aware of this, but the way God answered many of those prayers is by unleashing a defeat on enemies and oppressors. And that defeat takes the form of demonic activity. You pray for demons to fall and defeat the enemy, whether you are aware of it or not. Wow. When you pray for God's intervention, He answers by bringing a defeat that is brought about by Him using the enemy. Now, this is graduate level spiritual warfare. I can go back to milk. You know, I can teach milk. That's okay. That's okay. Yeah. Or you want a steak. I think this is a steak. I don't know, maybe I'm thinking too much myself. You be the judge. You be the judge. Let me show you a few other passages. Numbers 22, 21. You remember this passage. This is Balaam, when Balak comes and hires him, it says, or sends people to hire him, it says, "So Balaam arose in the morning and saddled his donkey and went with the leaders of Moab. But God was angry." I want you to underline this word, angry. God was angry because he was going. "And the angel of the Lord took his stand in the way as an adversary against him." Hebrew test. What do you think is the word adversary here in Hebrew? Listen to the man. Satan. That's in the Hebrew. Now, wait a minute. Let's read this again. "But God was angry because he was going, and the angel of the Lord took his stand in the way as a Satan against him." Wow. I'm telling you, this is graduate level. Verse 32. "The angel of the Lord said to him, 'Why have you struck your donkey these three times? Behold, I have come out as a Satan.'" As an adversary. Do I have this here? Yeah, I do. Okay. Verse 32. "Behold, I have come out as an adversary because your way was contrary to me." Because of your walk. Because you were about to do something that I had to do this to you. I had to oppose you as an adversary. I had to act. Wow, this is hard to swallow. I had to act like Satan in your life. Can you swallow this? This is heavy. I almost want to apologize, but I won't. 2 Samuel 24, 1, 2, because I have a lot more to show you. 2 Samuel 24, 1 and 2. Now again, the anger, I told you, underline this word anger, the anger of the Lord burned against Israel. And it incited, who incited, what incited? The anger of the Lord incited. What does inciting mean? To provoke, to motivate, right? Incited David against them, against the people of Israel, to say, go, number Israel and Judah. The king said to Joab, the commander of the army who was with him, go about now through all the tribes of Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, and register the people, that I may know the number of the people. And that specifically talks about the number of soldiers. So I know how strong my army is. Mm-hmm. And the Lord said, you shouldn't have done that.
Yeah.
Because you're going to trust in your own strength.
Yes.
And not in me.
Yeah.
And the Lord, and then the people suffered for this. And you can read the whole passage. But my point is this. We have a parallel passage. You know how so many times in, you read something in Samuel or Kings, and then you can read the same thing in Chronicles.
Yeah.
Well, here is 1 Chronicles 21, verse 1 and 2, same narrative as we saw in 2 Samuel. So it says, then Satan stood up against Israel and moved David. Now the word moved in the Hebrew is the same word insight in 2 Samuel. So now Satan stood up against Israel and moved David to number Israel. So David said to Joab and to the princes of the people, go number Israel from Beersheba to Dan and bring me word that I may know their number. Same passage. What's the difference here? The one passage says, let me go back, the one passage says at the beginning, the anger of the Lord incited David. The second passage, Satan moved David. Can you do math? The anger of the Lord equals Satan. The judgment of God is brought about by using the enemy. The serpent, the staff, represents judgment, which is the anger of the Lord, which is Satan. Ooh. What did you do that I brought this teaching to you today? Right? You wanted something easy and then, you know, coast all the way to lunch. 1 Kings 11:9. Now the Lord was angry. Now we know. Now our ears are ready, right? We're trained now. We read the word anger. We know something is up. Now the Lord was angry with Shlomo because his heart was turned away. Remember Balaam? Turned away. His heart was turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice. Verse 14. Then the Lord raised up a what? A Satan. That's in the Hebrew. The Lord raised up a Satan to Solomon. It was a human being. It says, Hadad the Edomite. Remember the get thee behind me, Satan?
Yeah.
It's, yeah, we can see it here a little bit. Because it's a person who the enemy is using.
Yes.
That's why.
Yes.
That's why Yeshua rebuked.
Yes.
He didn't rebuke only Peter. He did rebuke Peter, but he was rebuking Satan.
Yes.
Who was trying to use Peter?
Yes.
So here the Lord brought up a man. Allowed, let me put it this way, the Lord allowed this man by the power of the enemy to come and be an adversary to Saul, to bring correction into his life, because his heart was departing from the Lord. The Lord's correction in our lives many times take the form of the enemy's attacks and oppression. Romans 5. I glory in my suffering. I boast in my sufferings. Paul, many times persecuted by Satan, and the Lord bringing this correction into his life to sanctify him, to conform him into the image of his Son. So, then the Lord raised up an adversary to Solomon, Hadad the Edomite. He was of the royal line of Edom. Verse 23, God also raised up another adversary to Solomon, Rezon, or however you pronounce this, the son of Eliada, this is probably, the Lord knows, Eliada, my God knows. Now, who had fled from his lord, Hadadezer, king of Zobah. The Lord raised up another adversary to Solomon. Psalm 78:49. This is talking about the Exodus. He, the Lord, sent upon them, the Egyptians, his burning anger. Uh-oh, the anger. Here we go. Now we know. Fury and indignation and trouble. A band of destroying angels. The word destroying, ra. As in good and evil. Evil. An evil band of demons. What did they do? Watch. It says, verse 50. He, the Lord, leveled a path for his anger. He did not spare their soul from death, but gave over their life to the plague. What plague? Watch. And smote all the firstborn in Egypt. A band of demons executed the death of the firstborn of Egypt. Whew. Now you said, I thought it was the angel of the Lord. Adonai Tzvaot, Lord of hosts, a host of angels. Did he use demons? You bet.
Yes.
Let me show you a verse here. Deuteronomy 4:34. It says, or has a God tried to take for himself a nation from within another nation by trials, by signs and wonders, and by war, and by a mighty hand, and by an outstretched arm, and by great terrors? All of these things are the same. He's just quoting a synonym, and another synonym, and another synonym, and another. They mean the same. You see, if I may read it backwards, the great terrors is the same as the outstretched arm, and it is the same as the mighty hand, and it is the same as war, and it is the same as signs and wonders. Have you ever heard this phrase, signs and wonders? You have. We all have. It doesn't have a very good connotation in many circles, right? Signs and wonders, come, hear the preacher, and you're like, oh yeah, right, I'm going to turn the TV off. Signs and wonders is in Scripture. Now you know, in the book of Acts, signs and wonders, now that's the good signs and wonders. We pay attention to that one.
Yeah.
But what do they mean? We find it in the Torah. You see, the outstretched arm, the judgments, the plagues, they are the signs and wonders. That's what signs and wonders are. The Lord using the enemy to destroy the oppressor and to let the people go free. That's signs and wonders. Signs and wonders is not for people's entertainment. It is to minister through spiritual warfare,
yes,
freedom, redemption,
yes,
of people.
Amen.
To apply to the enemy the victory that the Lord has won for them, for us. That's signs and wonders. Another one here, Exodus 8, 17, in our last week's portion. They did so, and Aaron stretched out his hand with his staff and struck the dust of the earth, and there were gnats on man and beast. All the dust of the earth became gnats throughout all the land of Egypt. The magicians tried with their secret arts to bring forth gnats, but this time they couldn't. So there were gnats on man and beast. Verse 19. Then the magicians said to Pharaoh, "This is the finger of God. This is the finger of God." How did it happen? Through the staff. This is the finger of God. Okay, now watch this. Luke 11:20. Yeshua. "But if I cast out demons by the finger of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you."
Yes.
And Matthew 12:28. Mm-hmm. "But if I cast out demons," the same thing,
mm-hmm,
"by the Spirit of God."
Yes.
What or who is the finger of God? The Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Yes. And what does he do? He brings signs and wonders. And what are signs and wonders? The judgment of God coming upon the enemy to deliver people.
Yes.
Amen.
The Spirit of God, the,
yes,
finger of God, the, yes, kingdom of God,
yes,
comes upon you,
yes,
when the finger of God does signs and wonders,
yes,
among you.
Amen.
Signs and wonders, the true ones,
yes,
from the Spirit of God,
amen,
to deliver you and me.
Yes.
You see how God delivers people? You see how he redeems people? Well, signs and wonders occur when we apply this judgment, the judgment that took place on the cross. The death and resurrection of Yeshua is the judgment. And when we apply it, signs and wonders happen. People are set free. And the enemy is cast out. It happens by the finger of the Spirit of God. I am so glad that you have walked with me through this introduction to my sermon. See, the taskmasters that we see in Exodus chapter 1, they represent demonic oppression over believers. How do they oppress people? By counterfeiting the voice of God. Why? We already saw this. Because Shema Israel is how God creates, follow me here, the voice of God is how God creates. Didn't he do that in Genesis 1?
Amen.
Yes. Yeah. So the voice of God is how he creates in you and me the faith necessary to please him. We hear God so that he can create faith in us, so that then we can walk in his commandments, and he is pleased. Where do I get this from? Okay, I'm glad you asked. Hebrews 11:6. Now, without faith, it is impossible to please God, and you knew that. Romans 10:17, you also know this. So faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Messiah. Let's pause here. A lot going on in this one. So faith comes from. The word here is out of. The source of faith is hearing. So God, by speaking, he creates the faith necessary to please him.
Yes.
So faith comes out of hearing. And hearing, here's the same verb in the first part of the verse applies to the verb in the second part of the clause. These are two clauses that use one main verb. Sorry to go to English on you. So hearing comes, the same verb, hearing comes by. This preposition by here actually means through. Through the agency of. And he says the word of Messiah. Well, the word the article the is not in the Greek. So when you don't have a definite article the, then it is implied an indefinite article, which means a word. So it's not the word of Messiah, but it's a word, any word from Messiah. So faith originates from hearing God. And what do we hear? We hear a word from Mashiach.
Yes.
Now, let me see, do I have this? Okay, no, but later. I'm going to jump ahead and I'm going to tell you this. The word here for word, a word of Messiah, is the word rhema. The word rhema. The word rhema means a spoken word. It's a spoken word. What are we reading, John 1:1? In the beginning was the Logos. The word. It's not the rhema. It's not a spoken word. But it is the word. Yeshua himself is the living word. And in 2 Timothy 3:16 it says, all scripture is God-breathed. Scripture there is, the Greek is graphe. So follow this. We have three words to talk about the word. Right? One is the spoken word, here in Romans 10. The other one is the living word, right? Yeshua, Logos. And the third one is the written word, the graphe. We get the word graphic from it. The written word in 2 Timothy 3:16. Now, watch this. We are to read the written word, the graphe. We are to read the written word to get a spoken word. A rhema. From the living word, the Logos. We read scripture to hear the voice of Messiah. Because by hearing the voice of Messiah, that's where faith comes from. And so I can please God. That is why hearing is absolutely the way that heaven and earth touch each other, by hearing God. Now, Galatians 3:2. This is the only thing I want to find out from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by hearing with faith? By hearing with faith. Right? You receive the Spirit. In other words, you were saved. By hearing the Messiah, he spoke to you, and you believed in him. But it was not by the works of the law. What does the word, the work of the law mean here? Well, they found among the Dead Sea Scrolls something that is like a letter, and it has a title, and the title is Maaseh HaTorah, Maaseh HaTorah, the works of the law. Isn't that convenient? And so what we have in this little letter from the Dead Sea Scrolls, the works of the law, that's the title of it, the works of the law. And so he said, list of possibly the people from the Essenes telling someone else, perhaps the ones in control of the temple who are not following scripture and halakha the way it should be, according to them. And so they're writing, they're saying, this is what we believe, this is how you should do this, and this is what that means. And so it's a list of how are you supposed to walk the Torah. There's nothing wrong with the Torah, and there's nothing wrong with the works. We're called unto good works. That's not what Paul is saying here. Paul is not saying the Torah is bad or the works is bad. By the way, in the Hebrew New Testament, in the Hebrew, both the Dilich and the modern Hebrew scriptures, covenant scriptures, they use the word Maaseh. Well, actually, Dilich uses the phrase Maaseh HaTorah exactly the way it was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and he translated the New Testament way before they found the Dead Sea Scrolls. The modern Hebrew translation says the Mitzvot HaTorah, the commandments. So there's nothing wrong with the Torah, there's nothing wrong with the commandments, but what Paul is saying here, we continue on in verse 5, says, so then does he who provides you with the Spirit and works miracles. Stop right here. Works miracles. What do you think that is? Signs and wonders. He who provides freedom, the move of the Spirit among you, the miracles to set you free. How does he do it? Does he do it by the works of the law? No. Or does he do it by hearing with faith? Yes. Hearing is paramount. It's the way that the Spirit of God creates in us the faith to walk. So attempting to walk without the hearing, without the Spirit, goes nowhere. Goes nowhere. Verse 3. Are you so foolish? Having begun by the Spirit, are you now being perfected by the flesh? So notice the parallel here. The Spirit and the works of the law. The Spirit and walking by the flesh. You see, focusing on the works of the law, the Maaseh HaTorah, the Mitzvot HaTorah, focusing on that implies being doing it in the power of the flesh. Because it puts in contrast the Spirit and the works of the law. The Spirit and the flesh. We don't Again, we don't toss the mismo, but we do it by faith, by hearing. Mm-hmm. We go to the Torah mm-hmm. to get a word from the living word, Amen. A spoken word. Amen. Hearing Shema Israel yes. is my priority.
Yes.
And through that, the Lord works miracles Amen. Among us. And the kingdom of God is upon you when the finger of God, when the Spirit of God is performing His signs and wonders.
Mm-hmm.
The battleground is hearing. That's the real battleground. Yeshua walked the Torah by hearing God. Did you know that?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
How do you know that? Watch this. John 15:15.
Mm-hmm.
No longer do I call you slaves, for the slave does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard. Notice, Yeshua is hearing God. All things that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. So anything that Yeshua taught that we read of in the New Covenant Scriptures, He heard it from the Father.
Oh, yes.
He heard it from the Father. Everything. He was depending 100% on hearing God.
Yes.
That was his source. Yes. God was his source, but it was through hearing God. Hearing God is the battleground. John 5:19-20. Therefore, Yeshua answered them, Amen, amen, I tell you, the Son cannot do anything of himself. And the word here, of, means out of. Originating in himself. He cannot do anything out of himself. Originating in him. He can do only what he sees the Father doing. Only what he sees. You hear and you see. The Lord shows you. The Lord gives you a vision. The Spirit of God will come upon you and your what is it? Your young men will see visions, and your, I don't know which is the young men or the old men, I don't know, but you get, we know this, we know the passage. Vision, the Spirit of God comes upon you, and you see visions. Shows you visions. So, he can do only what he sees the Father doing. Whatever the Father does, the Son does likewise. Mm-hmm. Notice that in John 15, it talked about what he teaches. Everything that he taught came from hearing God. Now, everything that he does, the way he walks Torah, is by seeing the Father.
Yes, yes. That's good.
By getting into his prayer place, and even by walking every moment, he's walking and he's seeing God. God is revealing himself to him. He is hearing God. He is full of the Spirit. He's walking in the Spirit. And so the result is what he teaches is Torah. And what he walks is Torah. It's the Word of God. So verse 20. For the Father loves the Son and shows him everything he does. He will show him even greater works than these, so that you will be amazed. Greater works than these. What is he talking about? What is these? Well, we're in John 5. What happened in John 5? Yeshua's walking the pool of Bethesda, and, sorry, English is not my first language. You understand. So he's walking, and he sees this man, he can't walk. He heals him. Everything awesome, right? Except that he was on the Shabbat. Ooh. if he would have been walking by Ma'aseh Torah, by the works of the Torah, he would not have healed him. Absolutely not. But he was not. He was not walking in the interpretation of the commandments. That put the Sabbath as Lord and man as slave. That was not his walk. His walk was in the interpretation from the Father that the Sabbath was made for man. And so he healed a man intentionally on the Sabbath to teach Torah. Where did that come from? From seeing God. That's what our verse says. Greater works than these. What was the work that he did? Healed the man on the Sabbath. Came from seeing God. That was his Torah walk. That's where it came from. This is like cherry on the cake here. Did you know that even the Holy Spirit hears God? Now you say, come on, you're making that up. Watch. John 16:13. But when he, the Spirit of truth, what's the truth? The Torah. Yeshua is the living word. The Spirit of Torah, when he, the Spirit of Torah, comes, he will guide you into all the truth of the Torah, of the scripture, of the graphe, of this written word. And he's going to guide you by this spoken word. Guide is a personal speaking activity. He will guide you into all the truth. For he, the Holy Spirit, will not speak on his own initiative, but whatever he hears. The Holy Spirit hears. Wow. What humility. What an example of how this walk really should be. Did you know that the Holy Spirit hears the Father? Wow. It's beautiful. He will, whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will disclose to you what is Israel today is to live a life of faith as we see it in the book of Acts. What you have in the book of Acts is a bunch of Jews, zealous for the Torah, filled with the Spirit, hearing the Father, performing signs and wonders, giving it away to everybody they met.
Yes.
Healing and freedom in the Messiah, amen. Yeshua.
Amen.
That's the walk of Israel.
Amen.
That's what we want to walk.
Yes.
Amen.
That's our vision. That's our walk.
Amen.
I want to invite you to close your eyes. Ask the Lord for clarity. Think of yourself writing it down. What is he saying to you? So nail it in specific words. What exactly is he saying to you? You know, for some of you, this may be so loud and clear. He's putting you a sense of what he wants you to do, of the direction he wants you to go. Maybe unexpected. Or maybe you saw it coming and the Lord is confirming it to you. He's speaking to you. I know that. So what is he saying? What is he saying to you? Father, I pray that the spoken word of Messiah may be protected. protected from the birds of the earth, from the beast of the field, so that that word may be planted and be carried out, whatever it is, whatever direction it goes. Take away the fear. Take away the lies. Make this word pure. May it cleanse.